All right. So how long are we on for, though? Till like 8 or something? Or no, I mean, it's just like... All right, so we'll just have a kind of a conversation about this. That's Hondo and Fabian up there. That's kind of a book that came out in 2002 or 2003, and it won a Caldecott honor. And it was interesting at that time. I had a daughter who was like 4 years old, and I had a newborn baby boy. And when that book came out, it was like my third book that I made. And that book came out, and the New York Times in the spring when it came out had a 3-page review in the book review. Just crazy thing that just exploded. The New York Times, 3 pages, full pages with pictures about that book. And then that year came around and it was on everybody's lists. And when the Caldecott thing comes around, they select, the Caldecott selecting process is kind of crazy. And it just, but you don't want to expect to win the thing. And, but yet I was like, I was a front runner that year. I'm like, no, I think I could really win this. And they announce it at like 4 a.m. that you'd win. They call you on the phone. And when you know that's coming, or that you, if it doesn't come, then you just, the day opens up and you go make your coffee and I guess I didn't win, you know, it could have been like that. But I was really poor, not that I'm rich now, but I was really poor. And these books take me a long time. Each book takes at least a year the way I do it. And I try to make I want to make one really good book and have it sell rather than just keep flooding the market with my own books. You know, I just want to make one really good one. And so I got the call that I won the honor. I was hoping to win the gold. I got the silver medal. What they say is the same thing, but really it's not. You would want to win the gold. And the way the Caldecott committee picks out books, though, they always throw in they always pick a book like, what? Like, and it's like, I was prepared for that. So typically in life, you get what you want, but not quite. It's always like a little bit off. And that year, too, they gave out the award in Toronto. And I was all excited to go out there, but it was the year that they had the SARS epidemic, if you remember that. And nobody, like, it was underattended. It was like half the people showed up. Eric Carle got his big Lifetime Achievement Award, whatever they call that award, you know. And he gave his acceptance speech over video feed. And it was like, come on, man, show up. I mean, how many people got it, actually? It was like 12 people, and it wasn't that big. I mean, it was ridiculous. So that's a typical thing when you get the thing you want. It's always a little, you get it, no, you're a little bit back, you know. A little bit, no, a little bit, mostly yes, but now a little bit. SARS, you know, comes along. So that's Hondo and Fabian, and I drew this whole book. Can you hear me pretty good? Right? It's working. I can tell. I draw this in pencils and watercolors, and I draw very meticulously. And they take this drawing here would have taken about a week to draw. But then these are more recently. I've been working more in a funnier style, where it's in a lot of line work and ink, and then cross-hatching, and then really quick watercolors and some other colors on top. So it's more spontaneous and a little bit more funny. But this is from Henry in Love, and I'm gonna read this book to you later. It's funny, and it's to me, it's the best book. It's usually artists or writers make something and they, oh, I'm moving on to the next thing. But no, Henry in Love is perfect. I'm done. I don't need to make any more books. It's perfect to me. So this show I'm going to show you is a little different than the one I had in the schools today that I visited. This is more of the detailed show. It's got a little bit more early drawings. So when I grew up in a kind of suburban family where I had two older brothers and two younger sisters, and we had like two or three bedrooms. It was like a 3-bedroom house, and it was packed in there. We were all packed in. So I would have to escape the noise. I would go to my little desk area, and I would play 8-track tapes or of music, and then just zone out of everybody and just draw and draw and draw and draw, and just constantly been drawing and drawing and drawing, and that's what I would do for fun. So for kids out there, it's really good to let yourself kind of go crazy a little bit in your house or get really bored and just go to your little drawing station and just draw whatever and entertain yourself. So I'm not drawing like, oh, I want to draw a picture of something and I want to impress the teacher or something like that. I just draw for entertainment, and I've been doing that since I was a little kid all the way up to today. And so I draw for fun. And I don't really, it's nice that I make books. It's a way to pay the bills and I get to keep drawing. But I try to draw in a way that, and I teach at a college, the School of Visual Arts in New York. And I always tell my students, like they come in to take this children's book class, and I make them draw whatever they want. And there's a lot of power when you draw what you really want to draw. You don't draw or make books because you want to be a famous children's book artist. That's terrible. I mean, that would be the last thing you would want to think about. The best thing to do is, I always say is, okay, imagine you're in your town and they had some kind of nuclear explosion, a neutron bomb, and everyone's dead. And you're alive, but you happen to be near a Michael's store or an art supply store, and you got all the art supplies in the world for the rest of your life. And you're all alone. It's kind of like a Twilight Zone episode. I think they had a guy in a library that had that happen, and his glasses broke. And it's like, oh, I can't read now. But but everything's fine. You know, and you forgot about all the people anyway, so you're not depressed about it or anything. It's okay. Everything's fine. Or they just took you away in a helicopter and dropped you in this city, and everybody was taken away, but there's plenty of art supplies. Okay, so you get the point. So what would you draw if you were there? Would you draw? That's another thing. Like, if you were alone and no one would ever see it, would you draw? Or what would you do? If you were a musician, would you keep playing the guitar if nobody was around to hear it? I would, you know, so I would draw, and so I tend to draw the things like that. I make sure that I pass that thing. So I never draw for something. I draw whatever it would be for that moment. So this is a kind of a crazy drawing that I did when I was just going to art school. I was about 19 years old, so I'm a little older than most of the other students. It took me a while to figure out, can I make a living doing this? No, I can't make a living doing this. My dad worked for IBM, and he was like a business guy and everything. There's just nobody was making a living doing art. You can't make a living doing art. This is like 1989 or so when I finally did commit. So through the 80s, I couldn't see making a living as an artist. And when I thought of being an artist, I thought of being a fine artist. I didn't think of any kind of career or anything. And I didn't think of children's books. It was wasn't like I want to be a children's book artist. I just like to draw this stuff in my notebooks in college. I was kind of into mathematics and economics, and I was going through this whole process of that kind of a thing. But I could draw really good, and I was drawing stuff like this out of my head and showing people, and they're like, wow, that's really cool. So I said, all right, I better go to art school. And so I went to SVA, the School of Visual Arts in New York. And this is some stuff I like to draw. I like just draw anything I want out of my head, and I would like to draw dinosaurs. And this is before Jurassic Park and all this computer dinosaurs. So dinosaurs were more precious back then, before everything went digital and you can just, there's so many Discovery Channel and scientific stuff of dinosaurs and all the Jurassic Park movies. It's almost like a kid can just turn on the TV and just see a dinosaur. Okay, big deal. Okay, I'm done. But for me, growing up, it would be like there was only a few dinosaur books that had really good images of dinosaurs, and it would be a precious thing to create a dinosaur. So I loved drawing dinosaurs out of my head because that would be the only way to experience a dinosaur. And so this is a kind of a weird little drawing. This is kind of the beginning of the number thing. The kids have been asking me, why do you put numbers on stuff? You know, like, why is there a 3 on Jeremy and all this stuff? I don't know why, but when I'm just doodling in my sketchbook, I just drew this guy, and I drew him in his little uniform, and I put a 1.3 on his head. And then I'm like, all right, done. I don't know what that is. But I don't go into it thinking, oh, I gotta draw a picture of a guy with 1.3 on his head. I better hurry up and do that. It's more like you just get a pencil and you're just kind of bored. And sometimes you're pretty miserable. Being miserable is a really good state of mind to be in when you're doing art. You're just like, oh my, and you just kind of start drawing stuff for entertainment, and it just comes out pretty weird. And I'm like, wow, okay, that's pretty nice. And So that's the point, is that you don't think about what you're going to draw. Just kind of you're in this nuclear holocaust and you're all alone, and you just draw whatever that would be. So if I was alone and there was the Michaels and I had a paper and pencil, I'd probably draw something like that and then just throw it away. And when I was in art school, I would draw in pencils and a little bit of colored pencil. And I like putting this in there because there's like a dog here, this window and a tree and a television. A lot of these elements show up later, and it's not really deliberate. It's just kind of weird to see it now. I was almost like a premonition. But when I was in art school, I got a little bit better. And this is a creepy drawing. You see this creepy little monster, and there's a guy in a temple up there, and it's just, this is what I like to draw. This is like what I like. Very strange. And so this is what I really like. Now, when you draw this, you can't think, okay, I'm going to draw a picture of a crazy guy and a chicken and then I'm going to go do that. It doesn't work that way. You just kind of start probably around this elbow, draw this panicky guy wearing like a Roman toga thing around to the bull. Kind of this feeling was a little bit like Guernica, not on purpose, but you know, that panicky effect. And I think I was in art school living in New York City and just going crazy, you know? So this is what you're on your mind when you're in art school in New York City. Yeah. And so the chicken, and this chicken show up a lot in books, and there's a dragon, and it all works out kind of perfect. I wouldn't change anything. And there's a lot of mistakes in there that get kind of covered up as you go, but you live with it, and it's an organic kind of thing that flowers out. And that's the way it works. So I'm enjoying making it. I'm not drawing it to impress somebody, but that was the drawing that kind of got things going. And if you're ever in art school and you ever wonder how to be a professional or anything like that, it's not like when you're in art school you're preparing to be a professional. You try to be a professional in art school and then you get noticed, and that's what happened. A teacher would recommend you go see a publisher, and I met an editor and they gave me jobs. So it went from there. So this is a kind of a drawing. Oh, the picture got wide. I don't know. Okay, well, that makes sense. That works. I don't know why this image is stretched, but it doesn't matter. But that's a crazy drawing where it doesn't make any sense. This is a very strange one right there, right? Very strange drawing. So this is the stuff I like to do. But my first job out of art school was to do an op-ed drawing for the New York Times, the op-ed section of the New York Times. A little drawing in the middle there, and there's an airplane and an Indian, and they paid me $50, and then they lost the artwork, and that was my illustration career. Not a lot of money. So I finally got a chance, though, from the company to make a book cover. This is for Henry Holt and Company, and it's a really good publisher, and they gave me a manuscript, and I thought I was just going to be an illustrator. I came out of art school, and I studied math and stuff in college. I had no intention of being a writer. I just was an illustrator, and they gave me this scientific book to do that cover, and they paid me some decent money, but I knew if I did a really good job, it could lead to other things. And it led to, they said, how about you do a picture book, a children's picture book? And I go, okay. And it was written by John Coy, and they gave me a manuscript, and I just did 15 or 16 drawings. Took about more than a half a year, about almost a whole year, to draw all these drawings in the book. And you can see the car driving down the road, going past the deer, and it's about a father and a son. Okay, what's going on here? Okay, hold on. And then when that book was done, they said, all right, I thought, okay, can I have another? I got married, and everything was going along fine. I was becoming an illustrator. And they said, I asked, can I have another manuscript? And it's like, well, we have manuscripts, but it doesn't work that way. There's not like an assembly line of manuscripts and illustrators just kind of making books. They kind of cast that together. So they didn't really have a manuscript for me, but they said, how about you write your own book? And I'm like, whoa, I never thought of myself as a writer. And in fact, my SAT scores in English were really, really low. Like Forrest Gump really low. But I was really high in math, really, you know that mind, you know, that math low English score. But, which is funny though, because I'm a writer, whoa. So what I did is you can see I won an award here for this book. It was called Little Bunny on the Move. So when you want to be a writer, and for you kids out there, this is how you think. You don't think. You actually just draw what you want, like there's nobody around, and what would you draw? And so I get my paper out, and I think in a little bit, okay, I'm going to make a children's book. I know that. So I start drawing. What would look lovely is to see a white bunny on a beautiful dark background landscape and watch that little white shape move across the page. And you make a book, it goes, from left to right, and you turn the page, and I wanted to have that bunny move. And I thought, okay, the bunny's gonna move, little bunny on the move. And I wrote the words, it was time for a bunny to be on the move. From here to there, a bunny goes where a bunny must. After that, the words go downhill, but those were some of the best words I could do. And the bunny moves along. There's that same airplane. There's that same airplane that was in that op-ed piece drawing. I like drawing DC-3s. They're one of my favorite airplane. And in that night driving book, there was a 49 Plymouth. I like to draw that a lot. So I keep going back to certain things. And so the bunny is moving along. And when I draw in this method, it's pencils and watercolors. And pencils and watercolors make you draw grass really nice. You draw the pencils in the kind of a crosshatchy kind of flowing way, and then the wood is in the grain of the pencil and the paper, and then you add the watercolors. And so with these materials of just pencil and watercolor, it's a nice little harmony, you can create anything. Grass, bunny fur, wood, pigskin, then trains too, the train track. Really nice train, the bunny going over the train. But at this time in my career too, I was right out of art school. This is the first book I ever wrote, and I'm trying to show off a little bit. You know, my daughter was gonna, she wasn't born yet, but I had a wife, and we were intending on having a family, and so I was trying to be the best artist I could be. So it's a little show-offy, you know what I mean? It's a little show-offy. And I drew this little girl looking down at the bunny. This picture's a little stretched, I don't know why. And this method is, I draw everything in this gray graphite drawing, and you add little bits of watercolor, and it brings it all alive, like in the skin tones, and there's like oranges in there, and browns, and it creates a whole palette that I kind of invented. But we made this book because the baby was born at this point, and her name is Suki, my daughter Suki, who she's 19 years old now, so this is a long time ago. And it's my career now to be making these books. I'm working with Henry Holt and Company. I'm working with an editor. And she just let me do whatever I wanted. But at that point, my mind just locked up. And she said, how about you do a book about the baby? And I made this book called Baby Steps, which is a silly title. It wasn't my idea for a title. And that pink around it is somebody else's idea. But I drew the baby as perfectly as I could when the baby was born. And I was going to make this book about the baby, like a journal, like every month do a drawing and write something about that time. And that's where we were, you know, like a young family, it's just baby on the brain all the time. So the baby is born and I didn't realize, oh, look at this cute blanket. Then, that blanket is in every hospital, that certain pattern. But it goes like this. This is baby Suki. She's 1 day old. Their nurse wraps her tightly in a blanket. We call her our little burrito. And that was Suki. And then it went on from there. And there's my wife with the baby, and she's 1 month old. And then there's the baby Suki. It's kind of, you see the picture's kind of stretched? There's just something's going on with the projector. Don't worry about it. But there's the baby all 1 year old, and she walked away, and she was all good to go. But what was kind of interesting with that book was that it was under contract to do a book about the baby before the baby was actually born. My editor knew that the baby was coming. She knew I was thinking about it all the time. And so when the baby was born, it was really a tough pregnancy and a tough experience where the baby was like a cesarean baby and all this stuff. And they had the baby and it's just covered in goo and screaming and really ugly. And I was like, oh no, that baby's not gonna do for the book. This is not gonna work. She was screaming, and she had all this skin that was like wrinkled up, and it looked like she had this like horn or something going on, and like, oh, that's not so good. But then once they cleaned her up and put her in a little resting little heated table area, and I was alone with the baby, she relaxed and looked at me, and she was pretty. And I was like, oh, I can make a book together. And then it was funny, but by the time if she became a year old, she wasn't really walking. I'm like, come on, you gotta get walking so we can wrap this book up. I'm not gonna just leave people hanging here. Get going. I'm like, okay, there goes Suki, go, go, go. Just let's fake it here. So at that point, I have a baby. I'm living in New Jersey. We're living in this tiny little Sears bungalow house that's 800 square feet. And I'm working at a one bedroom, and my wife, the baby, and me are all sleeping in this other room. I had this one tiny kitchen. It was just ridiculous. But in that time, I was desperate and had to keep making books to pay for the family. And it's funny, when you start a children's book career, you think, okay, you're gonna pay me this amount of money for a book. And then you do pretty well. You get some certain awards, and they're like, well, what's the next book gonna be? It's just a little bit more, and it's a ridiculous amount of money for all the work. These books take a year to make, and it's not, it's, I mean, it is really low, the pay. But it's getting good. It got good after a while, but especially after winning a Caldecott honor. So this is Hondo and Fabian, and it started where I was in New Jersey, and I had to come up with another book idea, and I was at the beach in October throwing sticks into the waves and watching my yellow lab jump into the waves to get the sticks, and it's like, oh, that's a pretty scene. I could draw a book about that. And it was kind of boring though, so I threw the cat in for comic relief, and it became this Hondo and Fabian book, which had this certain rhythm to it. You know, the cat stays home or the dog does, and it's just this lovely kind of pattern that happens. Where it goes like this. Fabian on the windowsill, Hondo on the floor, two sleepy pets in their favorite places. Wake up, Hondo, time to go. Hondo will have an adventure. Fabian will stay home. And where is Hondo going, riding in a car? He's going to the beach to meet his friend Fred. Fabian is going to the living room to play with the baby. So that's how that kind of rolls along. And it was just this lovely rhythm, and there's a toilet paper scene that the kids all laugh at, and it wraps up. And it was just a silly little book, but it got all this fanfare. Like, it just really resonated with the critics and everything. And so that book won that Caldecott Award that I was talking about earlier. And then I was off and running, making books. And so my whole career has been based off of winning that little award and making Hondo and Fabian. And that was 2003, so it's 14 years since then, and I keep making books, and they keep paying me to make books. So I made another book after this, and it was called T is for Terrible, because I love to draw dinosaurs. I thought, wow, I won that award. They're letting me make whatever I want. And I made this book about a dinosaur. And it's kind of like, I am a dinosaur. I can't help it that I'm so terrible. And it was okay. The drawings are beautiful, like I was saying earlier. At this stage, I was kind of still like an art student out of art school, showing off a little bit, trying to get work, that kind of desperation. So you can see I really draw. These drawings take like a week or more sometimes. The next drawing that you see, this drawing here, it's really long. And with pencils and watercolors, it takes a long time. This might have taken 3 weeks to draw that. And I just thought, if I make a dinosaur book where there's a Tyrannosaurus Rex on every page, it's going to be the best book ever. And if I just do this, it'll be fine. And then you see at the end, I can't help it that I'm so terrible. But the book didn't sell that well, actually. I was really surprised. And I was on these book tours at that time, and it was around 2004. And I met Mo Willems on the road. You know, Mo Willems make, you know, the pigeon books and all that stuff. And his books are really fast. And he makes them, and they're really aggressive and funny. And I'm killing myself making these books. And I'm like, what's he doing? And I read the books, and I would read them to my children, and they loved his books. And then I'd read mine, and they're like, eh, they don't want that. So It's like, I gotta work on this. I gotta work on this writing. Like, I wasn't really a writer. But in the process, I was already, when that was going on, I was already in the middle of this book called Moonplane. And so I've had the airplane and the moon, and I've drawn these things over and over again. I love drawing the moon. And it all started, things are starting to change, where all those other books, I saw my dog at the beach, made a book about that. The baby, made a book about that. The bunny on the move was that was pretty original. But this one, I just went in and started making drawings. I didn't even have a concept. I just drew a boy, I just got the paper out and just started drawing all this grass and a boy looking up at an airplane. And I go, okay, there's a finished drawing. I don't know what's going to happen next, but I'm going to keep going with this. And then I drew, what would it be like if that boy were on that flight? Like, he imagines what it would be like to be on that airplane. So it starts off like a small boy looks up. He imagines what it's like to be on that flight, to travel over a car speeding down the tracks, to fly over a train speeding down, what did I say, going down the track? The car is going down the road, train speeding down the tracks. If that boy were on that airplane, he would fly into outer space. So I didn't even know it was going to be called Moonplane or Go to the Moon. I just went from drawing to drawing to drawing and wrote along the way. And so it was very organic, even though the drawings looked very precise, like I must have really thought about this and had it all figured out. But the dinosaur book was like that, but this one was more just let it go, enjoy the ride, and just see what happens. And the airplane went all the way to the moon. And on the moon, the small boy gets out of the airplane, and he jumps, and there's more pictures. I'm not going to show you all the pictures from that book. But the airplane comes back to his house, and he comes back to his mother, and he goes to sleep. And it was a perfect little story arc that has a story. It has this little twist where he goes to the moon and comes back to his mother. And then that book won an award. It was called the Charlotte Zolotow Award. I don't know if you ever heard of that, but it's a little award. It gets a medal for it and everything. And it's for writing in picture books. So it's not even for the pictures. It was for the writing. So I was like, that was pretty strange to win that award. And when I won that award, I felt like a scarecrow in a Wizard of Oz. You know, like where I wasn't a writer, I didn't have a brain, and they just gave me this like award, and I'm like, oh, now I'm a writer. And it's the scarecrow gets the certificate from the wizard. It's like, the two sides of an isosceles triangle are equal to the opposite. And it's like, suddenly I was a writer, and I wanted to make these big stories. And then I was off and going. After that, I made a book called Fabian Escapes, and it's over here, a sequel to Hondo and Fabian. And I made this book just so I could draw that drawing right there. Okay? Look at that cat jumping in the air. You can see his butt up there. Look at him. And then there's Hondo sleeping in the bed. Get out from there, Hondo. But in that time, I was drawing like I used to draw in art school, these little creatures and things, and these crazy monsters. So that's in my mind. That's still going around. Like, this has got to come out. But these are just drawings that I do for fun. But along the way, at that time, I wanted to work on some long, epic novel of all those creatures, a little bit more like an Alice in Wonderland thing. But I worked on it for a while, and I ran out of money, and I needed to make a book fast so I can get paid. And I thought of Mo Willems a lot, and I thought, man, if he can make a book really fast, I can make a book fast too. So I showed this drawing to my editor, or I showed her a bunch of drawings, and we just kind of came up with an idea really fast. This is just a page out of one of my sketchbooks where I just doodle for no reason, just like the apocalypse where there's a Michael's store. If I'm just drawing this guy, just this fat guy sitting there at a table by a window, and this just happens to be a drawing of a monster up there on the same piece of paper. But when you're drawing like that, really just fluidly, not really thinking of a story, it's suddenly like, oh, I got an idea. How about that guy draws that monster, and that monster becomes this really annoying roommate? And then we're just like, I'm in the office with my editor, Laura Godwin, and we're just laughing about this. And she came up with a lot of ideas. And I was just like, oh, yeah, that's really funny. I got to write that down. And I went home, slept on it one night, and woke up the next day. No, that's still a good idea. I'm going to do that. And I tried to make it as fast as I could so I can get paid, right? And so I made this book pretty fast in like 3 or 4 months, which is really fast for me, really crazy fast. And I didn't have a name of the character. I just knew that guy was going to draw that monster. So I changed the guy around a little bit. At this point, it was just called the dude. So there's the dude. Then I drew the dude many times over. And I drew this kid who was supposed to be looking at the dude going, what's wrong with you, man? But I realized, you know what? That should be the main character who draws the monster. And I have a brother-in-law named Jeremy, and that's a perfect name. So I'm like, all right, he's Jeremy. But the monster, what's the monster going to look like? And so I would draw the monster for fun, all these variations, and I'm trying to figure out what the monster would look like. And when you're drawing in your sketchbook, you draw stuff that doesn't matter. Like, what is that guy doing? There's just things just flow out, and it just became like that. I'm getting a little closer, and then bam, I made that monster. But the thing is when I'm making this book, like I'm making finishes, and they're going right in. They're going right in the book. Not a lot of planning. Not a lot of dummy book making or any of that stuff. What I have with me here is when I make books, I make a sheet like this. You can barely see it, but there's a lot of little doodles and little tiny thumbnails and a lot of writing. And it's almost like, you ever see a football coach in a football game? He's got like a play sheet like this, and he's calling the game, and he's looking at his play sheet. And so I make a book like, I doodle it out, and I just have it all there. And then I just go right into finals. And I don't think about it too much, and I deviate from this. This is just a really loose starting point. But I go right into the finals, and it became Jeremy Draws a Monster. And now I'm drawing with just a, like, talk about Michaels. I get him like a Marvy little marker, these tiny little waterproof markers that a kid would draw with. And I would draw everything with a primary, like a certain color. Except for Jeremy, and anybody that you see that's real, has a black outline with watercolors inside. So that was the formula, and I went right in. And I'm going to read this book to you guys. Who's ever heard of this book? Anybody ever hear of this book? All right, so this is a fun book. So I don't have the book with me, too, so I'm going to have to ad lib a little bit. I'm going to get mixed up a little bit on the words, but I'll try to go along. Jeremy lived on the top floor of a three-story apartment building. He never left. He never went outside. And you see he's got a little pen there, and he's looking out his window at the other kids playing outside. And on the pictures is a cat, a bunny, an airplane, and a dog. So it's really about me going crazy. So I'm out there, so he's there. So he had his very own room. He never left. He never went outside. One day, Jeremy took out his fancy pen, and he started to draw. He began at the top, and he continued over to the other side. Jeremy drew a monster. "Arg," said the monster. "Draw me a sandwich. I'm hungry." The monster did not say thank you. Then the monster growled, "Draw me a toaster." See, this is the part I forget. I wrote all these words. It's like the monster growled, "Draw me a toaster. I want toast. And draw me a checkerboard. I want to play checkers. And draw me a comfortable chair. And draw me a telephone. Somebody might call." But when I forgot the words, but I remember I drew all this stuff that Jeremy had to draw. It's like, "Draw me a toaster. I want toast. Draw me a checkerboard. I want to play checkers. And draw me a record player. It's too quiet around here. And draw me a comfortable chair. And draw me a hot dog, too. And draw me a television. I want to watch the game. And draw me a telephone. Somebody might call. And draw me a piece of cake. I want dessert." So this is how I work on it, and then there's Jeremy. And then the monster said, "Are you going to sit there all day? Draw me a hat. I'm going out." So Jeremy draws this hat. I don't know why he needs a hat to go out, but that's the way it works. And he puts on the hat. Jeremy was relieved that the monster was gone. But later that night, Jeremy heard bang, bang, bang at the door. The monster had returned. So that monster looks a lot like my dad, too, by the way. So just to let you know, there's got to be a lot of issues there. But and then look what happens. That is like the worst thing you can do to somebody. And look at him looking at it. What's he going to do? in his pajamas there. What was Jeremy going to do? So the next day, the next morning, Jeremy drew a bus ticket and a suitcase. And you can see what it says up there, one way. And as the monster, the monster's not too happy about this, right? So Jeremy led the monster out the door, down the stairs, out onto the street, and onto the next bus out of town. See, it says out of town on the bus. And the monster, look, he's really upset. He's doing it, though. And then, poof! Okay, this is a big drawing. I could barely fit it on the scanner, so you're missing a piece of it. But there's something really significant going on here. You guys know what it is? What's special about this picture? Anybody know? He's outside. That's it. And then the neighborhood kids, they're like, hey, do you want to play ball? It's like Jeremy said, okay. And so they did. And so it's one of those things, that's what it's about. So I didn't go into it thinking, oh, I really care about children getting out to play. It just kind of rose up. When you start drawing stuff without thinking too much, all these things rise up and it becomes really complicated. And it's better than you can think of, right away, or on purpose. So this is a crazy picture of this kid. This is me as a five-year-old or something. I think I'm in kindergarten, maybe preschool. And I have an extra middle tooth in the middle. I had three front teeth and this extra middle tooth. You ever hear of that? Anybody have an extra tooth in the middle? And so that was me as a weirdo. And I was thinking, this is the next book. And I had a really good editor at this time who helped me come up with this idea about what would life be like in kindergarten or in first grade. What was I thinking about back then? And so this book that I'm going to read to you now is really based off of my experience in kindergarten and preschool. And it's also based a little bit on The Graduate. You ever see The Graduate with Dustin Hoffman? It's a little bit of a mix of that. When I'm drawing this stuff, I'm not thinking, oh, I think a kid would like this book, so I'm going to make it because I think a kid will like it. I'm drawing it because I'm really into this. I mean, I listen to music, and so much music is about love and all that, so I'm going to make a love book. That's what I made. So when I'm making this book, I'm thinking just like Jeremy, what's this kid going to look like? That's me, really. I knew I was going to draw an animal character thing with animals wearing clothes. And so this is a page out of a doodle, and it's like, there it is, there he is, there's the kid. I can go with that. And then he's going to be in love with some girl in his class. Because when I was, I don't know what it is, since I've been in preschool on, I don't remember a time when it wasn't like this, but when I would show up at school, there would be some girl in the class that would be all about that. And if that, every year, if there was a year where I didn't have a girl that I had a crush on or something, that would be a bad year. I can't imagine that. And it went all the way until I got married, and that's what it happened. And so I picked this, who would he have a love interest for? And just look at that girl that he would have a crush on. This is like a little doodle. And it's a cat, a white cat. And you remember that lady in the story of the baby book, right? My wife? I pretty much took my wife's face and put it on that cat. So that's my wife there as a cat. And that's what my wife has, is she's Korean, and she has this expression on her face. When she's relaxed, she looks mad all the time. And it's like, what's the matter? It's like, nothing, what? It's like, so that's it, that's what that's about. So I'm doodling it, like what would happen? She gets to sit next to, okay, maybe that's how it's gonna work. So along the way, though, when you're writing for a book or when you're writing stuff, you draw and write at the same time. And I draw and write this little ditty, and it goes like this. One day, a big football player from the high school team walked by. He asked me if I played ball, and I said I did, and he said, good. To me, that's funny. It's just like, you see him? He's like 17 years old. He's a cool bunny. He's like tough. It's like, hey, what's up? You play ball? Yeah. Okay, cool. Like, all right. So to me, that would be a good day, if a big kid treated you nice. So I presented that to my publishers, and they were like, I said, whatever happens, that's going in. I don't know where it's going in. It's like, what, is he going to be in love with the football player? Yeah, nothing wrong with that. So it became Henry in Love. So this, to me, is the best book I ever did. It's got everything going on for it. You see, I'm not showing off as much. You see, remember those earlier drawings? They're all fancy. There's a little bit of showing off in this cross-hatching, so I'm getting obsessive about some of this stuff. But I let it be really clean and only draw what needs to be drawn, nothing more. And I draw, by the way, I draw everything by hand. No digital anything. If they need an extra flower, they can take one from some other part of the book. No, I'll draw you another flower, okay? I'm not gonna, no digital anything. And it starts off with these end papers. When you open up a book, you have the end papers. And it flows into the title page. So the title went above that picture there, and it said, Henry in Love. So you see this boy in a bed, in the flowers. And it starts like this. Henry awoke to the smell of blueberry muffins. He got ready for the day and headed downstairs to the kitchen. For breakfast, Henry and his brother Tim had cereal, toast, a banana, and a glass of juice. The blueberry muffins are for school, said their mother. And see, the blueberry muffins are pretty much drawn with the same pen as that monster, the blueberry muffin. That's like so many blueberries that the blueberry muffin actually turns blue. I don't know what that is. But the blue goes so nice with the brown, you know, it's a beautiful balance. Can I have one too, Mrs. Calico? Said Henry's friend Sancho. So with blueberry muffins in their backpacks, the three boys started for school. And there they are walking along. And along the way, they met a football player from the high school team. And there he is. And he said, you guys play ball? And they said they did. And then he said, okay, good, go deep. And he throws the ball. Way to go, little man, said the football player. You're pretty fast. I have a sister your age. She's fast, too. So there it is. There's the reason for his being. Henry knew his sister. He thought she was the loveliest girl in his class. So which one would it be? You know? Who would you be in love with? Would you be in love with the chicken? The cow? Everyone has their perfect person, right? There it is. Henry knew her name was Chloe, and she sat in the back row. And there it is. So you're getting closer, right? Are you looking at me? Chloe asked. So you can see this is what, you know, she's seeing him staring at her, and he's hallucinating back in that dream state. So for lunch, Henry had a peanut butter sandwich, an apple, and a carton of milk. The blueberry muffin he would save for the afternoon snack. But at recess, Henry decided he was going to walk up to Chloe. You're not going to talk to a girl, are you? Said Sancho. And there's Chloe. Henry did his best forward roll. See, there's some animation there. See that? Show him what you can do, Chloe, said Abby. Abby's the chicken. Chloe turned a perfect cartwheel. I just love doing that. Henry was impressed. Tag, you're it. A boy named Leonard tagged Henry, and the chase was on. So you can see who he's going to be chasing after, right? And there he goes around. So there are no words here. It's kind of like Donkey Kong, though, a little bit, right? You know, see that? But she's fast, right? Remember, she was fast. You will never catch me, said Chloe. But back in class, Mrs. Devine announced the new seating arrangements. Billy, you will sit here. Abby, you will sit there. Bessie, your desk will be there. Tyrone, you sit there. Sandra, your desk will be there. I just love giving names to all the characters, too. And Sancho, you put your desk right there. And Chloe, please move your desk next to Henry's. Now it was time for the afternoon snack. You can see which Chloe's got, right? The carrot there. What did you bring? Chloe asked. Pew! Thank you. Thank you, Henry, said Chloe. So, Chloe ate the blueberry muffin and Henry had a carrot. And that's the end of that book. You get that? See, that's, to me, that's a perfect book. So then after that, somebody had a book, Chloe. This is how Chloe got started. See, I made Chloe, and now it's like, I gotta make a book about Chloe. Also, when I make these children's books, I notice that a lot of these books that sell a lot at the picture book level are these pink girly books. I'm like, I wanna get in on that action. I wanna make a girl book. I've got Chloe, let's make a book about Chloe. And I start like this. This is how I start. I just start drawing a scene of flower or trees and a window, and there's a girl bunny in the window, and there's another bunny up there. And I drew a father bunny and a mother bunny. So Chloe had a father and a mother. And she had 10 older brothers and sisters and 10 younger brothers and sisters. Chloe was in the middle. And so that's how I start making this book. And then I would draw the book in brown inks, and I put Chloe in the window, and then her family spinning around her. And I start it all in this brown ink, and I would leave little gaps for where other things go, like the glasses and the bracelets and things and these other little details. I kind of knew they were coming. And I had to be really careful when I drew this that I would have to paint each kid with a certain color to make sure that, you know, a green one isn't next to a green one too many times and patterns and things. And it was really fun. And I don't work digitally, so if I make a mistake, I got to keep it. And it's so fun to work that way. And so there's the father and the mother, very close to the original sketch, too. I try to preserve that quality of just, boom, nailing it. There's a father and a mother. Chloe had 10 older brothers and sisters and 10 younger brothers and sisters. And you can recognize the football player guy who was in the other story. And Chloe was in the middle. That's it. When you add the watercolors and the little bit of other colors for stripes and sun and glasses, it's all colorful at that point. So that was Chloe. I mean, I'm not going to read that whole book. And recently I made a book called, oh, this is stretched a little bit, the Bunny Dreams book that's there. And in this show, this slideshow I have here, you can see the process. Oh, they stretched out. I don't know why that happened. I would draw in brown ink and then add color. I don't know why they get stretched out like that in this show. Must be something about the files. I dumped a lot of files into this slideshow. And yeah, that's kind of weird. But you see that drawing there? All the bunnies in the tunnels? And there's a chicken there with the bunnies. That's weird how it's stretched out. It's kind of cool looking, though. And then there's the bunny sleeping. Add a little bit of color. Yeah, that's weird. So that book is here. You could always see that. So this book is very strange. It's just a visual kind of experience that's kind of a dream book. Where do bunnies go when they sleep? And they sleep, and they dream of all these different things, and they learn to write their name and with paper and pens, and then one bunny starts to wake up. He's like, my name's not Bobby. And he wakes up from the dream. And he goes outside the tunnel, and what does he see? Oh, look, that's weird. He sees the moon. But I redid the moon, and that's the moon that he sees. A rabbit moon, that's right. So, but right now I'm at a stage where I finished that book, Bunny Dreams, over there, and I made another book that's here that's called The Tree in the Courtyard about Anne Frank. And so that's not really in the show, but it's such a new thing. I didn't scan it and put it together yet. But those books are out right now. But those are the last children's books that are in that format of like 32 pages or 40 pages. Right now I'm working on a book that has more of that aggressive kind of drawing that I did in art school of the creatures and things. And so I like to draw with inks and colors, but, well, that's a crazy long drawing of just weird stuff. And so these wolves on a boat, I was randomly just drawing these things, and I had a boy going on an adventure, And on the adventure, he meets these wolves on a boat. But I realized, you know what? I'm going to take the boy out of the story and make it about these five wolves. And I made this whole outline, and I pitched it to certain companies, and they agreed to do it. So this book is going to be 500 pages of a long adventure where the drawings and the pictures and words, and it flows like a children's book, but it's 500 pages. So it's not a comic book, and it's not a picture book, but it's an experience that an adult would enjoy as well. I mean, it's going to be a wild ride. There's going to be dragons and creatures, and it's going to feel dark like some of those other drawings that you saw, and it's going to be for an audience that might be older. So it's going to take about four years before you ever see it, because in the contract, and I just got this contract, okay, we're going to pay you this much money, and it's going to be 500 pages, and you have 3 years to make it. That's a strange feeling. So you're not going to see the book until 2020. It's very strange. This concept, when you make these contracts, are so far down the line. So that's what I'm working on right now. And there's creatures like this in that picture, in that book. So I can imagine this is kind of something I really want to do. But one more joke here. Jason had the best winter coat in school. He was cool. So there might be a book there. But that's the whole show for this one. There's a lot more drawings that I've done and everything, but I can answer any questions now if anybody has any questions. Any questions? No? Yeah?
Do you have just the two children, a son and a daughter?
Yeah, I have a daughter who's 19 years old and a son who's now, he's 14. That's just amazing. Because they were these children in those other books. I've been thinking about it a lot, how that was an era where we had little babies, and I was so concerned about children's books and career and working and trying to keep the family together that it went by so fast. And it's long gone. So it's amazing how time flies along. Yeah?
Henry Love is the best. Hondo and
Fabian. That is a good one. Hondo and Fabian, a lot of people like that one the best. Did you read the whole thing? Yeah, it's very nice. And it's funny too, right? There's a part in there where Fabian plays with the tissue paper and puts it on the floor. The true story of Fabian, Fabian would take tissue paper and roll it off the toilet paper roll, take the tissue paper, put it in the toilet, take it out again and put it on the floor. So we would never put toilet paper out, but when company comes, you put it out on the roll, and then you forget that you put it out there, and then Fabian does it again, puts it in the toilet and picks it out again. So that's a funny book. Hondo and Fabian's the perfect book. I mean, that is it. It's hard to do that over and over again. I got really lucky with that one. Yeah?
Do you ever have I noticed, like, this drawing that you have up now, when you would turn that into a drawing for a book, you would redraw that because it doesn't use the same technique that you use.
Yeah, sometimes like
do you ever have the experience that when you redraw it, you don't like it as much?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that is what I try to do as much as possible, is to draw finals right away, like not prepare them too much. And so you can see, like on Chloe, some of those preliminary sketches, and then you see the final, it looks almost exactly like that sketch. So sometimes what I do is, like, when the sketch is perfect, like sometimes it's just perfect. It could be the bottom corner of some like newspaper that you were doodling on, and it's just perfect. You know, and it's like, oh, I wish I did that on some fancy paper that I have set up. But sometimes you can take that and just scan it and then blow it up to a certain thing, and I can put that on a light table and I trace it almost exactly onto nicer paper, so you preserve that initial energy. But the thing is, what happens, you can't just eyeball it. You can't look at a drawing that you did here and transfer it over another piece of paper, because your mind will flatten things out and it gets really stiff. So you want to be able to kind of preserve that. So sometimes if it does turn out like a sketch like that and it's perfect, I will transfer it onto a piece of watercolor paper and then go from there. But if the eyeballs are off or something, or some kind of fur, or the posture is strange, you have to accept that. You have to keep it. You don't try to fix things later on. But I tried more and more to not even sketch it. Like sometimes I deliberately make my sketches so bleh, you know, like a little nothing, that so that when I go to a final, I just get a piece of paper. And sometimes I don't even know what I'm going to do. The best books, like the one I'm working that's 500 pages, I have an outline of what I want to have happen. I know what's going to be at the beginning, and I know what's going to happen at the end, and I have some vague ideas what's going on in the middle, but I don't want to know, actually, and I want to have it happen when you do the art itself. So you'd make a picture of a, like right now I had the wolves are crashed on a beach, and they're on the beach, and who do they meet at the beach? I don't know. They look down at the beach, and I draw a drawing for who do they see. And I drew a boy who just showed up with a number 3 tattooed onto his chest. And I'm like, all right, that's who it's going to be. And then you kind of go with that for a while. And it's more fun for me. So imagine if you knew exactly what you were going to do, and you had to make 500 pages of drawings, and you, like, say I wrote a manuscript and typed it all out, got it approved, it's all lovely, editors looked at it, it made some changes, and now I got to go draw the pictures for it. That would be a nightmare. That would be so boring to illustrate even my own manuscript that's a level of hell. I would not want to do that. So in a way, I kind of don't want to know what I'm going to do, but you can't be meandering. You can't just be where you have no, there's a kind of a balance there where you want to know what's going to happen. So I have this outline that I worked out that's really complicated. And if I explained it to you, if you read my outline, you would think that's ridiculous, and you wouldn't want to read it. So it's almost like I showed it to my agent, and I met with all these companies. I met with Scholastic, I met with Knopf, Random House, and all these companies. And I signed it up for a company called First Second Books, and I'm not supposed to tell you that yet. That's supposed to be a secret. But I signed up with them, but my agent said, don't show them the outline. They're going to hate it. It's like I did a lot of drawings to get it rolling. I actually started working on it. And to pitch the book idea, I actually had to do finals. I had to just do original drawings. And I made about 60 pages of the book and then showed them that. And they just said, oh, just keep going. But we want it to be 500 pages. And that's what I'm working on now. So it's very organic. And so, like I say in the process, and I've been talking to people, the best way to draw or to write anything is to not know what you're going to do, or don't even be grabbing for ideas in your head. Just get the paper out and just start writing, and it just comes out really good. And it just comes out better than what I could think about. Does that make sense? And so maybe it doesn't make sense. And that's the way to do things, I think. That's the best way to do things. I notice that when I see the Peter Cease paintings that are in the wall, on the murals that are here at this place. And there's a quality there. You can tell that he's enjoying what he's doing. It's really kind of, but you can't have that image in your head and then put it out on a piece of paper. You can't hold it in your head. It happens on the surface. Okay? That's how you do it. Yeah?
Because your drawings are so beautiful. How did you learn how to do even just the cross-hatching idea? You look at something and do it, or somebody teach you how to do that kind of thing? I mean,
well, I just started doing it since I was a little kid. You know, that my dad worked for IBM, and I lived in a suburban house in Poughkeepsie, New York. And I didn't have all these fancy materials, but my dad would always come home with these little notepads, this office supplies. Little notepads of white paper and these black ballpoint pens that said IBM on it. So we always had these ballpoint pens and white paper, and I would just draw with these ballpoint pens over, and I would draw like spaceships, I would draw dinosaurs, sharks, whatever I was into. And when I was drawing that stuff, I'd be making sound effects and things like that. So it's just like a movie to myself, you know? So I'm drawing like that, not thinking to impress anybody, but before I know it, I'm a college age guy, and I'm drawing, and I show it to somebody, and they're like, whoa, my God, that's amazing. And it's like, all right, I guess I should try, you know, it'd be a fun way to make a living. And I wasn't that great a math student. I wasn't that good. And I was like, that was passing, you know, okay. But I wasn't as smart as this next guy next to me, who was this scientist brain. I'm like, all right, I'm not going to be as good as that. But I could draw really, really good. I was just like, this must be what I'm supposed to do. So it's one of those things where I don't know. I don't know if it's like, okay, if I really want to be an artist and I work really hard, will I ever get there? I don't know, though. But I did spend a lot of those hours, you know, those that 10,000 hour thing, those concept of how much time you put into it. I put so much time into this stuff. It's just what I do every day. I draw that cross-hatching thing. Oh, you wouldn't believe. The amount of cross-hatching, I don't know.
So where do you write? Where do you draw?
Well, I took over this bedroom of my house that I have. I bought this like colonial house, and I thought I was going to build this studio onto it and stuff. But I like the lighting in the master bedroom. So I just kicked everybody out of the master bedroom, you know, and made that my studio. And it has the view of the trees all around, and the lighting comes in the window at a certain place, and it's just my little zone. But I work on this table that's not that big. It's like a little drawing table that I've had since 1984. It's the same table. And I keep looking, going to the art supply, I'm gonna get a new table. And I go to, no, my old table's still fine. But it's like a musical instrument. My table, my little stand of like supplies, I draw with a bunch of pens, like I have my favorite pens, and I keep it really simple, just like a musician. Like I make crosshatches in my stories, and the stories flow along like music. And so there's a rhythm to the crosshatching, and you turn the page, and it flows like a visual music. And that's what this 500-page book is going to be like, where you have crosshatchings of just space. And you turn the page, and you just get a field of grass. And you turn the page, and you just get space and maybe a planet. And you just kind of zoom in, and you just ride through it. And you can stay and just notice the crosshatching and just stay there for a moment, or you can move along. And it's kind of like what life is like. It's like what consciousness kind of feels like, you know, where you can just stay in the moment, or you can move along, stay, move along. And it's just kind of, you can go back and look at something earlier and kind of just be with the book. So that's kind of the way I work.
I don't know how to ask you, but you know, you do what you like to do.
Oh,
I mean, you may not have to time run out of ideas, something like that.
Yeah.
You have time, sometimes you struggle to bring new ideas, and if that, then how do you handle, or do you have some kind of a...
Yeah, the time is a big deal. I mean, it's like you have to set up. Maybe that's where the work is involved, like to set up your life to where you have the time to do it. I know like when you're in art school, you might take a job in something that's art related, but not absolutely this. Like maybe you take a job as like a graphic designer or something like that. Or a job that's art related, but not drawing what I really want to draw. That would be crazy. I would hate that. So I don't make a lot of money, but I make enough, and I try to live as cheap as possible where I can just work on one book at a time, not try to get it over with so I can get paid. Just the one book I did do that, The Jeremy Draws a Monster, I made that really fast on purpose to get paid, and it turned out funny though that way. So I'm just always drawing for fun. You know, it's like the book I'm working on now, it's going to take 3 years, and I can't think about getting it over with. I can't think about the time. They're paying me enough money where it's like I have the time. They're going to give me 3 years to draw what I want. And I can't be in a hurry to get it over with. I can't be like, oh, when this is done, I'll be really happy. I have to be happy right now. And so I make books like I'm almost playing Dungeons and Dragons with myself. You know, I'm playing a game. And I'm living the story as I draw it. So it's not work. It's fun, you know. But you do have to create that space of time, of no time. So we're not conscious of time. So where it just all smooths out. And you just draw one crosshatch, next crosshatch. You wouldn't believe how slow this is. It takes so long to make some of these drawings that have all those crosshatches going on. And but you can't hurry it along. You have to just kind of be happy where you're doing it.
It seems like you have a different mindset. Just these days, you know, parents, we really pushing our kids to have some creative mind and stuff. You know, it seems like you just naturally bring your idea.
Well, that's why I like coming to the schools and to come here and talk about this, because I think it's important to realize there's another way of thinking. I'm trying not to try not to be logical. You know, like if you do this, this, and this, and work really hard, you'll succeed. No, sometimes it's not trying, relaxing into the, whatever you're doing, that the quality actually rises up. It's philosophical, you know? And it's like music. You can't force music to happen. You have to enjoy it. And if you can tell a musician who's not having a good time, you know, it's something that has to be like that. But I think it works that way for all kinds of thinking. And yes, okay.
I wanted to take the opportunity to thank you for visiting from the beautiful Hudson River Valley to come to our equally beautiful planet.
Yes.
But I also want to give people a chance to, if they have any books that want to be signed or anything, we still have some time left on the library.
Sure. Okay, well, thank you very much.